Xong mình chơi những cái chỗ.
องค์ชุนุญญบเรศตลอดตะบงประกาศบรรทออกิจดำเนินการในเจ็ดวิธีสำนักการในสมเชิญลงวิธีสมกุลลงวิธีจีดบัตรจีดตะบงนี้ขยบัตรสมการอนุญาตปีลงวิธีดำใบออยโลกเคียวสมพรบานลางบัญชีពីចំហររបស់លោកតាក់ទងទៅនឹងការឆ្លើយចំពោះការតាំងសំណួរផ្សេងផ្សេងពីក្រុមពីចក្រមក៏ដូចជាភិក្ខុបញ្ជាក់ទៅលើចំហរដែលលោកបានឆ្លើយកាលពីថ្ងៃប្រហោះសប្តាហ៍មុនការថ្លែងនេះប្រហែលជាខ្លីទេត្រឹម5នាទីទេសូមលោកប្រធានអនុញ្ញាត
បាទអរគុណហើយចាំពេលណាមួយដែលសំស្របដើម្បីធ្វើកិច្ចការនោះមិនចេះតែធ្វើទីដោយផែនការនៃសមណការសប្តាហ៍នេះអង្គជំរះបានជំរាបភិក្ខុនិងសាធារណជនរួចហើយអំពីផែនការនៅក្នុងការកំណត់ការធ្វើសមណការដេញដោលលើឯកសារដែលត្រូវធ្វើពីថ្ងៃនេះទៅរហូតដល់ថ្ងៃទី19ខែមករាឆ្នាំ2012នេះនៅថ្ងៃនេះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនឹងមិនធ្វើសមណការដើម្បីស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មសក្សីឬជន់ជាប់ចោតណាម្នាក់ឡើយដោយដែលអង្គជំរះបានបញ្ជាក់ប្រាប់តាមរយៈអនុសរណៈ E159 របស់ខ្លួនរួចហើយសប្តាហ៍នេះគឺសម្រាប់សវនាការលើការជំទាស់របស់ភិក្ខុនានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងឯកសារជាក់លាក់មួយចំនួនឬប្រភេទឯកសារដែលត្រូវដាក់ចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះឯកសារនានាគឺជាផ្នែកមួយដ៏សំខាន់នៃភស្តុតាងនៃសំណុំរឿងលេខ002នេះភិក្ខុនានាបានជម្រាបមកអង្គជំរះអំពីការជំទាស់លើឯកសារជាក់លាក់ជាច្រើនយោងតាមខ្លឹមសារនៃអនុសរណៈ E159 អង្គជំនុំជម្រះនឹងស្ដាប់ការជំទាស់នានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងឯកសារដែលអង្គជំនុំជម្រះធ្លាប់បានដាក់លេខសម្គាល់ E3កាលពីថ្ងៃទី5ខែធ្នូឆ្នាំ2011អនុលោមតាមអនុសរណៈ E141 ឯកសារទាំងអស់ត្រូវបានលើកនៅត្រង់ជើងទំព័រនៃកថាខណ្ឌពាក់ព័ន្ធនិងប្រវត្តិនៅក្នុងដីកាដំណោះស្រាយត្រូវបានចាត់ថ្នាក់ជាប្រភេទឯកសារ E3 ហើយត្រូវបានអង្គជំនុំជម្រះចាត់ទុកថាឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះត្រូវបានដាក់ចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះកថាខណ្ឌ5នៃអនុសរណៈបន្តទៅនេះអង្គជំរះនឹងស្ដាប់ការជំទាស់ផ្ទាល់មាត់ភិក្ខុនីមួយនីមួយមានរយៈពេលចំនួន30នាទីដើម្បីលើកបញ្ហាភស្តុតាងទូទៅដែលមាននៅក្នុងឯកសារនានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសកម្មភាពនេះបន្តមកទៀតមេធាវីការពារក្តីមានរយៈពេលចំនួន90នាទីដើម្បីលើកឡើងសេចក្តីជំទាស់ទៅនឹងឯកសារទាំងឡាយដែលអង្គជំរះបានចាត់ថ្នាក់ជាប្រភេទឯកសារ E3 ដោយក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីនីមួយនីមួយមានចំនួន30នាទីលើកលែងតែមានការឯកភាពគ្នាផ្ទុយពីនេះពីសំណាក់ក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីទាំងអស់បន្ទាប់ពីនោះអង្គជំរះទុកពេល1ម៉ោងសម្រាប់សហប្រាជ្ញានិង15នាទីសម្រាប់សហមេធាវីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋរនីធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបបន្ទាប់មកក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីទាំងអស់មានរយៈពេល15នាទីដើម្បី ធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបដោយសង្ខេបនេះជាគោលបំណងនឹងការវិភាគនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្មនាការសម្រាប់សួរសម្មនាការសម្រាប់សប្តាហ៍នេះពាក់ព័ន្ធតែនឹងឯកសារដែលភាគីដាក់ចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនះតែប៉ុណ្ណោះជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះអង្គជំនះសូមប្រគល់វិទិកាទៅសហប្រញ្ញាហើយសហប្រញ្ញាមានរយៈពេលចំនួន30នាទីសម្រាប់លើកបញ្ហាផ្ោះតាងទូទៅដែលមានក្នុងឯកសារនានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសម្មនាការនេះសូមអញ្ជើញសហប្រញ្ញាលោកស្មីតជប់សិនលោកស្មីតបងអង្គុយសិនចុះសូមអញ្ជើញលោកមេធាវី
I'm sorry to interrupt.
My client would like to ask for permission to follow the
hearing from the hall
downstairs.
លោកមេធាវីកាពីក្តីនុនជាតើលោកសុំយ៉ាងម៉េចទៅសុំឲ្យច្បាស់លាស់សុំនៅពេលណាសម្រាប់ពេលណាឬក៏សុំនៅពេញនៅក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនៃការពិភាក្សាដេញដោលអំពីបញ្ហាឯកសារដែលអង្គជំនះគ្រងធ្វើពីថ្ងៃនេះដល់ថ្ងៃទី19
I said that my client would like to go to the holding cell. My client would actually like to go to the detention center. And it's not ideal for today. This morning the session will be an entire week. He would like to be fit for when he is
sabanakamuisabanadi time dong. This is what man ai mo chu rum no khong tri ban som no khong krom no tam dong.
បានស្ដាប់សំណើសុំរបស់មេធាវីកាពីក្តីជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាដែលបានស្នើសុំឲ្យកូនក្តីរបស់លោកឈ្មោះនួនជាអាចចាក់ចេញពីបន្ទប់សម្មនាការនេះទៅបន្តស្ដាប់ដំណើរការសម្មនាការពីចម្ងាយតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍នៅបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមនៃសាលសម្មនាការនេះអង្គជំរះយល់ព្រមតាមសំណើសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតដែលបានស្នើសុំតាមរយៈមេធាវីរបស់ខ្លួនដោយតម្រូវឲ្យជនជាប់ចោតទៅតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្មនាការពីចម្ងាយតាមពីបន្ទប់ដែលបានរៀបចំទុកនៅឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍នៅពីខាងក្រោមបន្ទប់សម្មនាការនេះពេញមួយក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្មនាការសម្រាប់សប្តាហ៍នេះពីថ្ងៃទី16រហូតដល់ថ្ងៃទី19តែម្ដងប៉ុន្តែក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីត្រូវប្រគល់ជូនមកអង្គជំនះភ្លាមៗនៅលិខិតលះបង់សិទ្ធចូលរួមសម្មនាការដោយផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្មនាការដោយចុះហត្ថលេខាឬប្រតិបត្តិដៃយ៉ាងជាក់ច្បាស់របស់ជនជាប់ចោតផងហើយសូមជម្រាបជូនមេធាវីនួនជាថាសូមរៀបចំនៅលិខិតលះបង់សិទ្ធនឹងឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ឲ្យបានក្បោះក្បាយមិនអាចធ្វើមួយបន្ទាត់ដោយសពដងបានទេបង្កប់ឲ្យអនុរៈមន្ត្រីឃុំឃាំងនាំជនជាប់ចោតទៅកាន់បន្ទប់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាទៅកាន់បន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមដែលបានរៀបចំទុកជាស្រេចនូវឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានសម្មនាការពីចម្ងាយហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យផ្នែកសោទស្សន៍ភ្ជាប់ប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតរូបនេះអាចបន្តតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្មនាការពីចម្ងាយគឺក្នុងរយៈពេល4ថ្ងៃគឺថ្ងៃទី7រហូតដល់ថ្ងៃទី19ខែមករា chanam pipon dap pini. Som nom vichok. Som chơi nhìn lục. Sao phê nhá.
Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. Good morning, civil parties, venerable monks, the audience here today, and the general public. Your Honours, firstly, we'd like to thank this chamber for allowing time to discuss the issue of documents early in the trial. The prosecution believe the issue of presenting documents to this chamber is critically important into being able to determine the truth of the facts in the allegations in the indictment. And we also appreciate the opportunity to say a few words about what the parties believe the test of admissibility should be for documents. Of course, documents should only be admitted in this case if they meet the legal standard. Your Honours, I will outline the legal test for the prosecution this morning. This afternoon, my colleague, Mr. Darrow's May Chan, and I will respond to the defence objections, particularly in relation to the historical sections of the closing order and the pre-1975 paragraphs relating to the three accused. Your Honours, I have four main points I would like to convey this morning, and that is firstly, the importance of documentary evidence in cases of this size. Secondly, the legal test to be applied. Thirdly, the indicia of reliability we would suggest would be useful in determining whether or not documents are reliable. And fifthly, a few words on the distinction between the admissibility of documents and the weight of documents to be attached to them. Your Honours, it's widely accepted that documentary evidence is an important way for courts dealing with large criminal allegations to determine the truth of them. For some matters of proof, oral testimony can be a less effective way to determine the truth compared to the admission of documents. This is due to a few factors such as the different opportunities individuals have to be able to perceive events at the time, the different abilities people have to be able to remember events at the time, and particularly in light of the case where testimony has been taken 30 to 40 years later. Also, the role of a witness or an accused in the events and their current living circumstances and his or her relationship with an accused or with other witnesses and the pressure of giving evidence in a public trial can cause at times an individual either to minimize their evidence or perhaps to overstate it or to exaggerate it or at some times even not to be completely truthful about the facts. These, of course, are issues Your Honours will be taking into account when you hear oral testimony on a case-by-case basis when you give weight to that testimony at the end of the case. Your Honours, in contrast to oral testimony, documents produced at the time of the alleged criminal events are able to capture important information about those events permanently, like a photograph that does not fade like a memory. Later, when the document is presented at trial, information captured at the time in a document cannot be understated or overstated, as it has been permanently recorded. This, of course, will assist Your Honours in ascertaining the truth. In cases of this size, the admission of non-contemporaneous documents are also deemed to be important to assist the truth-finding process. Documents prepared by experts who have studied events and details in detail over years and the statements of many witnesses who are victims of crimes in the closing order enable the trial chamber to understand the context and the overall factual situation, the subject of the indictment. Particularly when dealing with massive countrywide grave human rights violations committed over a long period of time pursuant to government policies, admission of such material to provide an accurate context to the assessment of the core allegations of trial is extremely useful. It allows the trial chamber to have a complete and accurate overview. It allows you to see a more complete picture of their events and their context in this trial. International tribunals have adopted this practice, subject to certain conditions, so that judges in trials relating to crimes against humanity cases can comprehensively and accurately determine the relevant facts without having to examine every victim that has suffered. This would be a process that would cause the trial to never end if that happened. In doing so, however, the courts have been able to find a balance between preserving the rights of an accused to a fair trial and the right of an accused to an expeditious one. The importance placed on documentary evidence of the other international tribunals can be seen in the number of documents admitted by trial chambers. For example, in the case of Perlich, case number IT0474, where there were six accused, the trial chamber accepted just under 10,000 exhibits, approximately half tendered by the prosecution and half by the defence. In the Gotovina and Markich case, IT0690, which entailed three accused, the trial chamber admitted over 4,800 exhibits from the and half from the prosecution and just under half from the defence. And Your Honours have admitted about 1,000 documents in the case of Doi, a far smaller case than this, dealing with one security centre as opposed to the large-scale allegations and widespread allegations and the number of accused, as well as the position that these accused have taken, perhaps comparatively to that of Doi. In this case, we are dealing with the allegations of the forcible movement of the Cambodian population across the country and other related crimes. That's the current situation. Allegations that the accused were on top of the administrative, political, and military structures, which were kept secret in large part from the public. Your Honours, the allegations in the indictment are in many cases more extensive than the trials held in other international tribunals. Consequently, the necessity to consider a comprehensive body of documentary evidence in addition to oral testimony to determine the truth will be critical. What then is the legal standard required to have these documents admitted at the ECCC? The legal test for admission of documents is contained in Rule 87. Rule 87.1 provides the general rule that all evidence is admissible, subject to Rule 87.3, which I will discuss shortly. The rule is derived, as you know, from the principle of the free evaluation of evidence in the French civil law system, which forms the basis of the criminal justice system of Cambodia. A consequence of this principle is that the judge in the hearing must have an intimate conviction of the guilt of the accused, and that's contained in the French version of Rule 87.1 in the rules at the ECC, before a conviction can be entered. This fundamental principle that judges can freely evaluate evidence and not in a restricted manner is also supported by international jurisprudence. Trial chambers at the ICTY, in cases involving multiple accused, have adopted guidelines on the standards governing the admission of evidence. In cases such as Bernardin and Talich, 2002, Starkich, 2002, and Martich in 2006. The Yangsari defence, in their submission earlier this year, have argued that guidance can be taken by the trial chamber from these guidelines. And that's in E59, in his motion relating to the use of all material on the 24th of February 2011. The guidelines, Your Honours, which are uniform in context, established the following practice on the admissibility of documents. I quote, "Parties should always bear in mind the basic distinction that exists between the admissibility of documentary evidence and the weight that documentary evidence is given under the principle of the free evaluation of evidence. The practice will be, therefore, in favour of admissibility. Unquote. Your Honours, that's the guidelines that trial chambers at the Yugoslavia Tribunal have used, and bearing in mind that system was built on more of a common law system, they still adopt this broad principle that trial chamber judges should see all the evidence subject to some certain restrictions. So, Your Honours, Rule 87.1 creates a presumption of admissibility in keeping with the civil law principle and international standards that evidence should be freely evaluated to assist judges to arrive at their intimate conviction in the case as to whether or not the guilt of the accused is proved. That said, Your Honours, 87.1 is limited by 87.3. And 87.3, as you know, sets out the grounds on which some evidence can be excluded, where the evidence is irrelevant or repetitious, impossible to obtain within a reasonable period of time, unsuitable to prove the facts it purports to prove, and not allowed under the law, or intended to prolong proceedings or is frivolous. In the Doit case, in decisions E188, E434 and E176, Your Honours have interpreted the effect of Rule 87.3 as requiring evidence to satisfy, and I quote, certain conditions of relevance and probative value, and quote, minimum standards of relevance and reliability to be admitted. We submit this approach is in line with the approach taken at international criminal tribunals dealing with similar types of cases. In the ICC case of Lubanga, in its 20th of January decision 2011, at paragraph 27, that chamber held that for evidence to be considered relevant, the evidence proffered must be prima facie material to the issues and tend to establish the party's position. Should this first criteria be satisfied, the inquiry then turns to the reliability of the evidence. In the ICTY case of Dlalich, the Appeals Chamber decision of the 4th of March 1998, paragraph 20, they held for evidence to be considered reliable, the evidence proffered must be prima facie credible. The criteria for such an assessment depending on the particular circumstances of each case. It's also in the Lubanga decision just mentioned at paragraph 29. So as a document is required to be prima facie relevant and credible, what does the term prima facie mean? A Latin term, it means at first sight, or as further described by Black's Law Dictionary, on first appearance, but subject to further evidence or information. Or by the Oxford Dictionary, prima facie is stated as at first sight, on the face of it, as it appears without investigation, based or founded on the first impression. Thus, Your Honours, in its proper use, in the context of assessing the relevance or credibility of a document, prima facie would refer to the first impression of the relevance and reliability gathered when seeing and holding the document, but subject to countervailing considerations that may warrant further investigation. Therefore, we submit that the interpretation of prima facie is most consistent with the principle of the free evaluation of evidence is that when it is said that a document is prima facie relevant and reliable, this means that, based on first impressions, a judge may presume the document to be relevant and reliable unless rebutted by evidence to the contrary. At the ad hoc international criminal tribunals, The rules of procedure and evidence provide for the trial chamber to, if they wish, to request verification of the authenticity of evidence obtained out of court. And that's ICTY Rule 89E and ICTR Rule 89D. Your Honours, this rule is permissive rather than mandatory, and certainly does not amount to a requirement of proof of authenticity beyond reasonable doubt. One leading commentator, drawing on the case law of the International Criminal Tribunals, summarized the position as to authenticity as follows, and this is Christopher Gosnell, Admissibility of Evidence in the Principles of Evidence in International Criminal Justice, 2010, at page 387 to 388. I quote, "The tendering party, as part of showing reliability, is expected to provide some indication as to what the document is and that it's genuine. This requirement is often referred to as authentication, but the concept bears no relation to the technical concept of authentication in some domestic legal systems. Authentication in international courts means no more than that the document is actually what the moving party purports it to be, based on the available indicia of reliability. The author or custodian of a document need not, for example, testify in court for a document to be authenticated, nor need it be recognized or commented upon by any witness whatsoever. No chain of custody need be established, and submissions about the provenance of a document by the parties themselves are often accepted in lieu of direct testimony or submissions by an investigator. A document's," end quote. A document's authenticity, in other words, Your Honours, namely that the document is what it purports to be, is related to its reliability, but authenticity itself need not be proven prior to the admission of the document and is not a separate requirement for admission. There is no requirement for authenticity of a document to be definitively established, as suggested by the defence in this case. Rather, the evidence must have a sufficient indicia of reliability considered as a whole to be admissible. Proof as to the origin of the document and the chain of custody of the document, of course, is a relevant factor in considering whether a document has sufficient indicia of reliability, but it's not a prerequisite for admission. Your Honour, the ECC law do not provide a set of reliability indicators for documents. However, through the practice of the international criminal courts, with cases of similar magnitude, by reviewing those decisions, some indicators can be adduced by trial chambers like yourselves, commenting on what they believe are factors to assist in proving reliability. Looking at all of those cases together and those different factors, the prosecution has put forward a number of indicators that we would ask Your Honours to look at when determining reliability of documents and if those minimum characteristics are met. The courts look at two factors in examining the reliability of a document: its internal characteristics and its external characteristics. Looking at its internal characteristics, if the document has a source or an author, that's an indicator of reliability. Was the document created by an official or a public source, or is the source or author otherwise identifiable? That adds to its reliability. Does the document have markings on it? Does it have a signature, a stamp, a seal, a fingerprint, a reference, or a code? Does it have a postmark or other similar markings? They look at the form of the document. Is the handwriting or the typeface of the document consistent with other documents of that type or consistent with documents of that source or from that author? Is the layout and format of the document consistent with other documents of that type or from that source or from that author? The date of creation, was the document created contemporaneously with the events that the document purports to record? The contents of the document, does the document use distinctive syntax or distinctive expressions commonly used by the source or author? Or the document, does it contain information about persons, places and events that could be only within the knowledge of the source, the organization, or the author? The purpose of the document, is the purpose of the document identifiable, and is it consistent with the known policies of the source, of the organization, or of the author? Does the document have internal consistency? Is the information in the document internally consistent? Or is it consistent with information in a related document? They are some of the internal factors that other trial chambers have looked at to determine whether it has sufficient indicia of reliability. Looking at the external characteristics of a document, other factors have included to determine reliability, whether the document has been authenticated. Has the document or documents of a similar nature been confirmed to be an authentic document by the author, or by a witness with knowledge, or by an expert witness? Identification, has the document or similar documents been reviewed by an author or a witness with knowledge or by an expert, and that person did not raise any challenge to its authenticity, giving rise to a presumption of authenticity? Is the document corroborated by other information? The persons, places and events, is that consistent with what corresponds to other documents and other testimony as to the truth of its contents? Do we know where the document was discovered? Is the place of discovery known? Is the place of discovery readily explicable? For example, where the documents were actually found, is that consistent, that place consistent where you would expect documents of that type to be found? Or having where they were found, does that have a link to the source or the author or the recipient of the document? And lastly, custody. Are the circumstances of the provision of the document, how the parties or the investigative judges obtained the document, are they, do we know them? As opposed to a party just producing documents to the chamber and saying they landed on the front doorstep. Your Honour, therefore, there are a broad consideration of factors, some of which are very obvious and are often overlooked, rather than a technical narrow focus on one or two single criteria that should be applied in determining authenticity. Your Honours have already ruled on the fact that originals of documents are not required in order to be admitted before this case. Your Honours, this is in line with the jurisprudence of other tribunals where copies are regularly relied upon. Just turning now to the distinction between admissibility versus weight or the probative value of the evidence. The probative value or weight of evidence has been described in international jurisprudence and academic commentary as a component of relevance, reliability, or both. As such, the requirement for evidence to have a probative value at the admissibility stage can be satisfied by showing that indicia of relevance, that prima facie relevance, and that indicia or prima facie reliability. On the other hand, Your Honours, the Special Court for Sierra Leone, the trial chamber in the case of Charles Taylor, in its contemporaneous document decision of the 22nd of September 2010, held that the actual probative value or weight to be afforded to the evidence is assessed by the trial chamber once all the evidence has been heard. The burden is on the parties seeking to introduce the evidence to demonstrate minimum levels or prima facie levels of relevance and reliability. There is no requirement for the proffering party or the tendering party to establish that the evidence is of a high probative value. As has been noted by this trial chamber and by other international criminal tribunals, the assessment of the actual probative value of the evidence or weight to be assigned to it is a separate inquiry, and ultimately that weight can only be fully given once all the evidence has been heard. As Your Honour has held in the Deutsch judgment, E188, paragraph 42, this inquiry takes place once the evidence has been admitted, with the purpose of determining whether it tends to prove or disprove the allegations in the case. It is submitted that this minimum standard for admissibility is appropriate in proceedings before the ECC, where the evidence is collected or reviewed by an impartial and independent investigative judge, and the triers of fact are experienced professional judges and not a jury of laypersons. This distinction between trials conducted by judges, professional judges, and juries is regularly made by the international criminal courts. Your Honours, to briefly conclude, the defence seeks to set the threshold for admissibility unduly high in requiring the prosecution or any party for that matter to positively establish the authenticity of the documents. When the international jurisprudence has established that, there is in fact no such burden upon any of the parties. Rather, it is for the judges who are able, by virtue of your training and experience, to assess the evidence in light of the established criteria and to make a decision as to authenticity and therefore admissibility. The mere fact that evidence is admitted does not presuppose the weight that will be given to that particular document. The judges will hear the evidence in the context in which it was obtained and accord it appropriate weight at a later stage in the proceedings. In many cases, an original of a document may not be available, or the provenance of a document may not be proved. Yet, as we've seen under international criminal law, the absence of these features do not necessarily make the document unreliable and preclude its admissibility. At all times, it's open to the defence and any other party to challenge the authenticity of a document. However, it would be entirely impractical and incorrect in law to establish a blanket requirement that all evidence be admitted onto the case file meet or admitted at trial meets a higher threshold than the criteria that is established by international jurisprudence in these types of cases. That's the end of our submission, Your Honour.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank ជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះអង្គជំរះសូមបកគលវេទិកាទៅសហមិត្តវិនមុខតំណាងដើមរងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីសហមិត្តវិមានពេលចំនួនធំទំនេទីដើម្បីលើកឡើងអំពីបញ្ហាផ្ោះតាងទូទៅដែលមានការពាក់ឯកសារនានាដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសហមនាការ
Bonjour Monsieur le Président, bonjour Madame et Messieurs les juges, mes respects aux moines et bonjour à tous. Nous allons profiter de cette opportunité qui nous est donnée de faire quelques observations d'ordre très général de notre point de vue de partie civile. Ces observations porteront à la fois sur les pièces du dossier visées par les notes de bas de page, mais aussi sur les autres pièces apportées par les parties. Nos observations nous paraissent d'ailleurs complémentaires de celles qui viennent d'être faites par les procureurs. Je vais évoquer deux séries d'observations. La première série sera relative à la recevabilité des pièces au regard du rôle du juge d'instruction devant les CETC. Et la seconde série d'observations sera relative à la jurisprudence des CETC. Mais tout d'abord et de façon préliminaire, permettez-nous d'exprimer un certain étonnement à la lecture des multiples objections qui ont été soulevées jusqu'à maintenant par la défense. Nombre d'entre elles nous semblent avoir déjà été tranchées, soit par la loi et le règlement intérieur des CETC en particulier, soit par la jurisprudence des CETC en particulier, ainsi que d'autres juridictions internationales. Le fait de soulever à nouveau de telles objections ne relève évidemment pas d'une mauvaise connaissance de la loi applicable de la part de la défense, mais probablement d'une volonté délibérée de nier cette loi, de nier le règlement intérieur et de nier la jurisprudence afférente. Une telle position nous paraît dilatoire et nous sommes portés atteinte aux droits de toutes les parties et particulièrement ceux de la partie civile d'obtenir une décision de justice dans un délai raisonnable. Nous sommes ici, tout le monde le sait, dans un système de droit romano-germanique inspiré de la procédure pénale cambodgienne. Le règlement intérieur est établi dans ce cadre. Ce système peut ne pas convenir à certains, mais c'est celui qui est en vigueur, c'est celui qui s'applique. Dans un tel système, et M. le procureur l'a rappelé, la preuve est libre. Et dans un tel système, les juges sont investis du pouvoir de rendre leurs décisions selon leur intime conviction. Quand je parle des juges, il s'agit bien sûr des juges de la chambre de jugement, mais avant elle, il s'agit aussi des juges d'instruction et le cas échéant de la chambre préliminaire. Des pièces sont versées au dossier. Certaines résultent des actes d'investigation et d'instruction menés par les juges d'instruction. J'y reviendrai. D'autres sont fournis par les parties. Comme l'a indiqué M. le procureur, leur valeur probante, leur poids probant seront appréciés par la chambre pour établir son intime conviction et la vérité. La chambre, à la fin du procès, au moment de rendre sa décision, examinera si ces pièces, leur contenu, la façon dont elles ont été recueillies sont suffisantes pour établir la culpabilité au-delà du doute raisonnable et dans leur intime conviction. C'est d'ailleurs ce qu'a rappelé votre chambre dans son mémorandum E-159, le paragraphe 6, à la fin du procès. La chambre évaluera la valeur probante des pièces. Avant cela, de façon distincte, la question de la recevabilité s'est posée. Elle ne se pose pas juste maintenant, elle s'est posée depuis le début de l'instruction, depuis que des juges d'instruction sont chargés de constituer un dossier de preuve. Cette question de la recevabilité, on ne peut pas la poser sans cesse et sans cesse de façon répétitive lorsque les questions ont déjà été tranchées, soit par le règlement intérieur, soit par des décisions antérieures des juges d'instruction ou de la chambre. On ne peut pas la poser de façon répétitive, cette question de recevabilité, précisément parce que nous sommes dans un système de droit romano-germanique et que par conséquent, la valeur juridictionnelle des décisions des juges d'instruction ne peut pas être remise en cause à l'exception de l'appel devant la chambre préliminaire. Pour cette raison, il nous semble que la recevabilité aujourd'hui ne pourrait être discutée que dans les très strictes limites de la règle 87. Et en pareil cas, il appartiendra à celui qui soulève cette objection d'en établir le bien fondé. Encore une fois, M. le procureur l'a souligné, mais je voudrais le souligner, il paraît essentiel de bien distinguer entre la phase de la recevabilité et la phase de la valeur probante qui emportera la conviction des juges et de la chambre. Ma dernière remarque préliminaire est celle-ci. En soulevant ces objections, la défense fait référence à son droit à un procès équitable. Mais au moment d'examiner les objections, il est important de rappeler que le procès équitable, ce n'est pas le privilège de la défense, c'est aussi un droit pour les parties civiles. De la même façon, la défense évoque parfois l'éventuelle partialité des parties civiles qui fragiliserait leur déclaration. Mais là encore, la partialité n'est pas le propre de la partie civile. C'est aussi ce qui caractérise la défense, ce qui caractérise toutes les parties dans un procès. Les juges, en revanche, tous les juges, à tous les stades du procès, sont impartiaux. Et cela m'amène à ma première série d'observations concernant la recevabilité au regard du rôle des juges d'instruction. Je ne crois pas qu'en formulant ces objections, la défense accepte réellement de prendre en considération le rôle des juges d'instruction, leur statut de magistrat disposant d'un réel pouvoir juridictionnel décisionnel. Leurs décisions, leurs actes ont cette valeur juridictionnelle et décisionnelle, tout comme les décisions et les actes de la Chambre de jugement. La présence du greffier auprès des juges d'instruction est une manière d'authentifier les actes et les décisions de ce juge, comme la présence d'un greffier auprès de la Chambre est une manière d'authentifier les actes et les décisions de la Chambre. Les juges d'instruction instruisent à charge et à décharge. Je crois qu'il est peut-être important de le rappeler encore. L'intérêt des juges d'instruction dans le système des chambres extraordinaires, l'intérêt de ces juges d'instruction dans cette phase d'investigation, c'est précisément d'apporter à la Chambre un matériel suffisant et suffisamment sérieux qui permette à celle-ci de ne pas recommencer la collecte des pièces. Dans les paragraphes 1320 à 1324 de leur ordonnance de clôture dans le cas 002, les juges d'instruction ont pris le soin de préciser que l'ensemble des pièces versées par eux dans le dossier, c'est-à-dire toutes celles visées par les notes de battage, l'ensemble de ces pièces doit être suffisamment sérieux et corroborer les charges pour fournir un certain niveau de force probante et soutenir la notion, le principe d'établir des charges suffisantes telles qu'il relève de la responsabilité du juge d'instruction. Les juges d'instruction ont donc procédé à cette vérification et ce que la défense demande aujourd'hui à la Chambre de faire, c'est ce que les juges d'instruction ont déjà fait dans le cadre de leur pouvoir juridictionnel et décisionnel. Je ne parle bien sûr que de la recevabilité et non de la force probante du poids qui seront appréciés par la Chambre au terme du procès. Faut-il rappeler aussi que selon les règles 55 à 62 du règlement intérieur, les juges d'instruction vérifient la pertinence, la fiabilité et l'authenticité des pièces qu'ils reçoivent et qu'ils décident de verser au dossier. Faut-il rappeler que lorsqu'ils procèdent à des interrogatoires, ceux-ci sont écrits, puis authentifiés par leur auteur et authentifiés également par le greffier. Faut-il rappeler que les actes, les pièces, peuvent être discutées, contestées, confrontées, et cette opportunité est sans cesse rappelée tout au cours de l'instruction. Le fait de ne pas saisir cette opportunité s'analyse en une acceptation implicite relativement aux documents concernés. Faut-il rappeler encore qu'au terme de leurs investigations, les juges d'instruction ont soumis leurs conclusions fondées sur les pièces de procédure et les autres à toutes les parties et que cela a ouvert un nouveau droit de contestation dans un délai fixé par le règlement intérieur durant lequel les parties ont pu faire valoir les dites contestations.
Enfin,
faut-il rappeler que l'ordonnance de clôture qui est raisonnée et fondée sur les pièces utilisées par les juges d'instruction est susceptible d'appel. C'est multiples possibilités de contester les actes des juges d'instruction et les pièces sur lesquelles ils s'appuient ont précisément pour objet de vider la question de la recevabilité et d'en décharger la chambre. Enfin, l'ordonnance de clôture, en se fondant sur les pièces visées aux notes de bas de page, en retient nécessairement le caractère pertinent, la fiabilité et l'authenticité de façon définitive lorsque les recours sont épuisés, ce qui est le cas dans le cas 002. La recevabilité ne devrait donc plus concerner que des cas tout à fait exceptionnels et les contestations devraient être dûment justifiées par ceux qui les invoquent dans le cadre strict de la règle 87. Plus encore, en application de la règle 76.7 du règlement intérieur, faut-il rappeler que les actes de procédure pris par les juges d'instruction et les documents en résultant, tels que les PV d'interrogatoire, sont couverts par l'ordonnance de clôture et aucune nullité ne peut plus être invoquée à leur encontre. Rien ne justifie aujourd'hui que l'on nie cette règle et son application, qu'on en tire les conséquences. Cette règle découle simplement du pouvoir juridictionnel et décisionnel des juges d'instruction. Dans le cadre de cette première série d'observations, je voudrais également souligner un point relatif à la recevabilité des parties civiles. De ce pouvoir juridictionnel et décisionnel des juges d'instruction, il résulte une autre évidence relative à la recevabilité des parties civiles. Lorsque les juges d'instruction se prononcent sur la recevabilité des parties civiles, ou bien lorsque la chambre préliminaire le fait, après eux, le cas échéant, ils se fondent sur les déclarations liminaires, les dépôts de plainte ou les interrogatoires, Mais en tout état de cause, leur décision est justifiée par de tels documents, fondés par ces documents, et en conséquence, la pertinence, la fiabilité, l'authenticité de ces documents, les déclarations, quelles qu'elles soient, des parties civiles, sont implicitement, mais nécessairement, jugées suffisantes par le juge d'instruction. S'il ne retenait pas cette pertinence, cette fiabilité, cette authenticité, il ne pourrait pas déclarer comme recevables les constitutions de parties civiles. Or, ils ont déclaré recevables quelque 3900 parties civiles et dans leur pouvoir décisionnel et juridictionnel, ils ont donc considéré que les déclarations de ces personnes étaient pertinentes, fiables et authentiques. Cette recevabilité des parties civiles, nous le savons tous, ne relève que de la juridiction de l'instruction. Elle ne peut pas être à nouveau contestée, pas plus que les pièces qui la fondent, sauf à retirer au juge d'instruction leur pouvoir juridictionnel et décisionnel. Ainsi, aujourd'hui, il me semble que les questions de recevabilité et les objections de la défense doivent être analysées à la lumière des décisions qui ont été prises par les juges d'instruction et qui ont une valeur définitive aujourd'hui et qui ont statué sur la pertinence, la fiabilité et l'authenticité. Ma deuxième série d'observations tient au fait que on ne peut pas soulever des objections et la Chambre ne pourra pas apprécier ces objections sans tenir compte des décisions déjà rendues par les chambres extraordinaires elles-mêmes, soit au stade de l'instruction, soit dans le cas numéro 1, soit dans le cas numéro 2. Je crois qu'il est important de souligner que nombre des objections soulevées par la défense ont d'ores et déjà été tranchées et qu'il n'y a pas lieu de les soulever aujourd'hui, sinon dans un but dilatoire. Je vais simplement citer quelques exemples de décisions. Cette liste n'est pas exhaustive et je ne développerai pas sur le contenu des décisions car je pense que les débats nous amènerons à en discuter le contenu, mais j'inviterai chacun à regarder par exemple la décision E43-4 de la Chambre du 26 mai 2009 dans le cas numéro 1, laquelle se prononce sur la façon d'analyser les documents recueillis par des tiers. À cette occasion, elle distingue entre le cas où le document concerne le contexte historique ou le cas où le document concerne le comportement d'un accusé. Dans cette même décision, la Chambre précise ce que j'ai indiqué tout à l'heure, les actes de procédure effectués par les juges d'instruction et les documents qui en résultent sont définitivement purgés de toute nullité par l'ordonnance de clôture, à la différence des autres documents. Dans leur ordonnance de clôture, dans le cas numéro 2, qui est une décision juridictionnelle, les juges d'instruction, dans leur paragraphe 1320 à 1324, et je l'ai dit tout à l'heure, ont expliqué de quelle façon ils avaient fondé cette ordonnance sur des pièces dont ils ont apprécié le caractère suffisamment sérieux. Dans sa décision E176 de septembre 2009, dans le cas numéro 1, la Chambre a rappelé que les parties disposant de l'opportunité de contester les pièces pendant la phase de l'instruction peut importer ensuite que ces parties aient usé ou non de ce droit, les pièces sont alors considérées comme non contestées. Dans son jugement du 26 juillet 2010, E188, la Chambre évoque les notions d'intime conviction et de culpabilité établie au-delà du doute raisonnable pour relever la proximité de ces deux notions. Dans ce même jugement, au paragraphe 52 et 53, la Chambre insiste sur la valeur de la déposition d'une partie civile qui dépose, non pas comme témoin, mais comme partie au procès, tout comme les accusés. Ces décisions constituent la jurisprudence des CETC. On ne peut pas les ignorer aujourd'hui. On doit en tenir compte. Les objections doivent les prendre en compte en premier lieu. Je l'ai dit, cette liste n'est pas exhaustive, bien sûr, et elle n'est pas analytique non plus, nous y reviendrons. Mais elle avait pour but de souligner qu'il existe déjà des décisions relatives aux objectifs. Je voudrais également faire une observation d'ordre général sur les motifs qui ont amené la partie civile à déposer tous les formulaires de dépôt des plaintes et de constitution partie. Je ne vais pas rentrer dans le détail des raisons qui nous ont amenés à faire cela. Mais je souhaite indiquer, comme je l'ai fait tout à l'heure, que ces éléments ont constitué la base de la recevabilité des parties civiles, laquelle est aujourd'hui indiscutable, ne peut plus être remise en cause. Ces éléments ont donc tous leur importance. Ils ont aussi une importance factuelle, à la fois par les détails qu'ils apportent et à la fois par la quantité des déclarations qui convergent à certains moments vers les mêmes descriptions, soit du contexte, soit des faits, soit des souffrances. Il est donc très important que ces pièces soient maintenues au dossier. Elles ont une valeur d'authenticité et de pertinence particulièrement qui justifie leur présence et qu'on les retienne pour apprécier la culpabilité des accusés. Voilà les quelques observations que la partie civile souhaitait faire à titre général en début de cette audience. Je vous remercie.
Monsieur le Président, Madame et Messieurs les
députés, je vous remercie. មិត្តវិមានពេល 30 នាទីសម្រាប់លើកបញ្ហាផ្ទាល់ទូទៅដែលមាននៅក្នុងឯកសារនានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសម្មនាការសូមអញ្ជើញ
Good morning everyone.
សូម អរគុណ លោកប្រធានជំរាបសួរអរលោកលោកស្រីទាំងអស់តើបញ្ហាទូទៅការកត់សម្គាល់ជាទូទៅនោះគឺថាខ្ញុំសូមលើកឡើងជាសង្ខេបទេ
First of all, as to the applicable law, we'd like to know at the outset that given the nature of the ECCC and the limited number of provisions relating to the admission of documents contained in the Cambodian Code of Criminal Procedure, which is, as we have submitted many times, the primary and controlling body in procedural law at this tribunal, the Chamber has a great deal of flexibility in how to proceed with respect to documents. Having reviewed the comprehensive submissions of the parties on the admission of documentary evidence and with the benefit of reference to the various jurisprudence cited by the parties, we are now in a unique position to craft a policy on the admission and ultimate evaluation of documents that, among other things, respects the applicable Cambodian procedure, reflects the best aspects of international criminal practice, and, perhaps most importantly, robustly protects the rights of Nguyen Chia and the other accused. There is no need to slavishly follow the jurisprudence of other international tribunals. Rather, this chamber can and should think for itself in determining how best to move forward. At the ECCC, the starting point for any policy on the admission and use of documentary evidence must be reference to the Cambodian Criminal Procedure Code. In particular, Article 334. Elegant in its simplicity, that code provides no significant hurdles with respect to the right to present material documentary evidence at trial. Rather, quite simply states, until the end of the trial hearing, the accused may submit all documents and evidence that he thinks will be conducive to ascertaining the truth. As to the admission of documents, the Chamber has already made it quite clear that it intends to follow the international practice, this two-pronged approach, with respect to the initial assessment of prima facie relevance and reliability test governs the admissibility. Following that, a more thorough and comprehensive assessment as to the weight and probative value is conducted by the chamber. That, as we've said, is the international approach. That is clearly the position the chamber is going to apply. We accept that. However, as it does not in any way offend the applicable Cambodian procedure, we will not object to it as such. As a general approach, we feel it's reasonable, flexible, and capable of protecting Munshia's rights. My third point goes to the preference for the original documents under Cambodian law and practice. So the international approach that clearly will be applied here can and must be harmonized with standard Cambodian practices. As Major Sonnaroon informed the chamber last week, based on his nearly 20 years of experience in the Cambodian courts, copies of documents are not accepted. They're not accepted unless the original versions have been produced in court and their authenticity verified. I'm sure the experienced Cambodian jurists on the bench are well aware of this practice. In fact, it is in line with the so-called best evidence rule, which is cited frequently in the international jurisprudence, which does make a point of stating a preference for the production of original documents. The prosecution has submitted that it cannot be reasonably tasked with presenting the original versions of the tens of thousands of documents on which it would like the chamber to rely. However, we submit that the OCP is certainly in a position to provide at least some of those documents. We know, for example, that many of these documents are available to the OCP in their original form. And we take the position that those documents which relate to the acts and conduct of the accused and pivotal issues in the case, especially the ones presented to Munshia in court, those documents should be presented in their original format. And we saw last week that that amounted to no more than 10 documents, if my numbers are correct. And as I said, there's no practical impediment to producing these documents. We have the testimony of Mr. Yu Chang of the Documentary Center of Cambodia. He's on record as saying that many, if not all of the documents, the original documents that the OCP has tendered are available in Cambodia. They are available in Cambodia in their original format. And while we do acknowledge the international co-prosecutor's concern that the presentation of every single original document would considerably slow down the trial, such a pragmatic argument cannot be used to trump the rights of the accused to sufficiently challenge the evidence presented against him. We think, in fairness, that a reasonable balance can be struck, and we think that it should be struck. The proper point at which it should be struck is on the question of acts and conduct of the accused and pivotal issues in the case. Where such documents go to those issues, the originals should be presented in court for the accused comment and assessment. Major Sonnaroon is telling me to slow down. I'll try and do that. Again, and this is the flip side of what we would call the acts and conduct of the accused evidence. As we've stated, that and the prosecution has stated, and we agree with them, where statements relate to the acts and conduct of the accused person, the accused has a right, and this is a quote from one of the prosecution's submissions, has a right to confront the maker of that statement. So we would stand by that. We would support our colleagues on the other side of the stage. And we would say that the flip side of that is that perhaps a lower standard of admissibility, relevance, reliability, could be applied to contextual evidence, to background evidence, to documentary material that does not go to the acts and conduct of the accused. But we do state, and we do believe that that standard, which the prosecution has said, as to acts and conduct of the accused, should apply to all documents on the case file, not just, for example, the witness statements taken by the OCIJ or witness statements taken by the prosecution in its original investigation. Any document which goes to the acts and conduct of the accused should be presented in court in original format, and its author should be called for cross-examination. On to my fifth point. While the international criminal practice on the admission of documents has been criticized as being far too lenient at times and presenting too high a risk of contamination or unreliable evidence, we take the position that this chamber must be mindful of those criticisms, must take them into account, in ensuring that the relevance and reliability of any material it seeks to rely on is established. As civil law judges, you have a positive obligation to satisfy yourselves that any document you rely upon for any reason, among other things, is authentic. Yet to date, there has been a seeming willingness to shift this burden to the party somehow. While there is indeed, as the International Court Prosecutor has stated, a prima facie onus on the tendering party, we take the position that this limited responsibility cannot absolve you, the judges, of your positive obligation to ensure that all the evidence you rely upon, all of it, ultimately is what it purports to be. The burden is not on the defense to show that documents are inauthentic. And while the party should be encouraged to make challenges and submissions throughout with respect to potential documentary evidence, the chamber's important role as the arbiter of the truth cannot be delegated. Again, this is, after all, a civil law jurisdiction. We do acknowledge a reasonable approach to the OCP's initial submission on indicia of reliance and relevance and reliability of its tender documents. We read that document, we reviewed it, we think it was a very, very reasonable initiative. We're happy they did that. However, once the accused, especially in court, on being presented with a document, once the accused challenges the authenticity of that document, we submit that the onus then reasonably shifts to the prosecution to provide a further indication of that document's legitimacy, especially when no original has been provided. Simply unauthenticated or inauthentic material must be excluded from the process. And it may not support any finding of fact against any accused person. There has been a suggestion by the President, again today quite vehemently by my colleague across the stage for the civil parties, that challenges to authenticity are somehow foreclosed because the judicial investigation is finished. We categorically reject that position. It has no basis in law. Clearly, authenticity is an open question until the close of trial. I thought there was an objection. Slow down. Thank you. Getting back to yes, we categorically reject that position. Clearly, authenticity is an open question, a question that remains open until the close of the case. It can only be determined upon consideration of all the evidence presented in the case and all the challenges presented by the parties up and until the final day in court. As noted, we do accept the provisional admission of documents at this stage, provided the threshold requirements, the prima facie requirements are met, but we do reject any suggestion that these admitted documents can be presumed authentic. Accordingly, we hereby seek from the chamber an unequivocal indication that questions of authenticity remain open, subject to debate, and continued submission to the very end of the case. A brief word on chain of custody. We certainly welcome the chamber's initiative to call a representative from the Documentation Center of Cambodia next week, I believe, to provide information regarding the chain of custody, some of those DC CAM documents. My brother at the New York Bar, Jesper Pau, will make submissions later today on this point, so I will not comment further, except to say that we trust this decision will serve as a precedent for the calling of additional document custodians in the future, including, for example, Mr. Hugh Kanneret. My ninth point goes to the reliance on the case file and new documents. We've made extensive written submissions on this point already, so I won't take up too much time. But as we've argued already, and as we've argued since the beginning of the case. And as I said earlier today, we do say that Article 334 of the Cambodian Code of Criminal Procedure permits the admission of all documents until the end of the trial here. We are not foreclosed at any stage from presenting documentary evidence. We have previously announced that we would strive to notify the chamber and the parties of those documents that we intend to rely upon, and we will do that. We will do that by the end of this week. We will present documents, a document list in particular, in regard to those documents that we intend to put through TCE 38, who we understand will be testifying probably at some point during this session. Regarding the chamber's position with respect to the admission of new documents, we find it's unsettling that judges in a civil law trial should wish to articulate such an exclusionary approach to potential evidence. The primary role of this chamber, rather than simply mediating evidentiary disputes between the parties, is, as already noted, it's to affirmatively ascertain the truth. Yet somehow the judges appear to have preempted the admission of as yet unseen documentary material through the imposition of an unnecessarily strict standard. We take issue with this, as we have in our filings. We suggest that the chamber should adopt a broad approach, an approach consistent with Cambodian law, in particular Article 334. While the chamber clearly has the inherent power to implement measures designed to effectuate a smooth and efficient trial, it cannot deny fundamental substantive rights which are afforded to the accused persons under the applicable Cambodian law. My tenth and final point, Nong Chia's right to remain silent. This was taken up by the judges last week several times by the President, in fact. The chamber announced that when Nong Chia sought to obtain the original version of documents put to him, that he was in fact somehow exercising his right to remain silent in response to those questions. For the record, we object to this constructive invocation of one of his most important and fundamental rights. Clearly, challenging the authenticity of a copy of a document does not amount to anything more than that. As Mr. Pesman noted last week, what my client is in fact doing is not exercising his right to remain silent. He's challenging the authenticity of the copy. That's what he's done. As we've noted, as Nong Chia himself has noted in this regard, he is more than willing to give evidence on documents, and he has suggested that an advanced copy or advanced copies of those documents be presented to him for his review so that he may assist the chamber. The chamber has not ruled on that yet. However, we're expecting a decision soon. We think it's a reasonable request. And we do think that the expectation that he is somehow to be immediately familiar with documents presented to him is unreasonable under the circumstances. The case file is large, it's complex. I don't think any one of us in this room would be immediately familiar with the documents presented to us without any advance warning. So I think just as we are required to give some advance notice of the documents we intend to rely upon, just as we have done that, we think that's a reasonable practice to adopt with respect to the accused. And he stands by that request that was made last week. And finally, just let me say that we have no intention of running roughshod over the rights of any party, let alone the civil parties. We simply seek to protect the rights of Nong Chia. And one last point, which I feel I have to make, the co-investigating judges do indeed enjoy a presumption of impartiality. However, we do not accept, and we have never accepted, that presumption in any way coincides with reality. Thank you, Your Honors. That's all I have.
ខ្ញុំជំនួយយើងខ្ញុំគឺចង់ក្រោយនេះអាចអរគុណអ្នកឲ្យសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានលោកលោកស្រីចៅក្រុមបាទអរគុណសម្រាប់មិត្តភ័យនីតិចាប់ពីពេលនេះតទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 11 ខ្វះមិត្តភ័យនីតិសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ដនការសូមអញ្ជើញលោកអង្គឧត្តម
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំបាទសូមលោកប្រធានមេត្តាអនុញ្ញាត
ហើយលោកអៀងសេរីចូលរួមសវនាការពីបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមបន្ទប់រងចាំសម្រាប់ឲ្យសវនាការទាំងមូលគឺសវនាការដែលដល់លើខោតាំងនេះគឺចាប់ផ្ដើមពីថ្ងៃនេះរហូតដល់ថ្ងៃទី19សូមលោកធានមេត្តាអនុញ្ញាត
អង្គជំរះយល់ព្រមតាមដំណើរសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីដែលបានធ្វើសុំតាមជាមេធាវីរបស់ខ្លួនដោយសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធមិនចូលរួមផ្ទាល់ក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ដនាការនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្ដនាការនេះដោយតាមមូលហេតុសម្ដនាការនេះជាសម្ដនាការពិនិត្យដេញដោលលើភស្តុតាងឯកសារដោយបន្តទៅការតាមដានពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួននៅខាងក្រោមបន្ទប់សម្ដនាការនេះដោយមានឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍ ប៉ុន្តែក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីត្រូវប្រគល់មកឲ្យអង្គជំរះនៅលិខិតលះបង់សិទ្ធមិនចូលរួមសម្ដនាការដោយផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្ដនាការនេះដោយមានចុះលេខាឬក៏បដិបត្តិនៃដៃជាក់ច្បាស់ពីជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីហើយបង្គាប់ឲ្យអនុរិយអំពីខំខាំងនាំនៅខ្លួនជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីទៅកាន់បន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមចុះហើយនឹងទាំងពីរនាក់ទាំងនួនជានឹងអៀងសេរីនេះគឺ
ឲ្យគាត់នៅទីនោះនៅក្នុងប្លង់ពេលនៃដំណើរការសម្ដនាការសម្រាប់សប្ដាហ៍នេះហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យផ្នែកសោទស្សន៍ភ្ជាប់ប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីមានលទ្ធភាពតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ដនាការពីចម្ងាយសូមនាំទៅចុះឲ្យសម្រាប់ចុះ